Welcome to Your Voice, a program for you to see how your voice is being heard in the New York State Senate with Senator John DeFrancisco. I'm Julia Locandy. Hi, Senator.
How are you?
Good. How are you?
I'm doing well. We had a busy weekend this weekend and still recovering from that, but it's been a lot of activity that's been going on in Central New York.
You went to an honor flight ceremony.
Yeah, that was terrific. Here's a photo. These are World War II vets who, through contributions, were sent, brought down to Washington, and they went to Arlington and saw the changing of the guard and met the general who was the head of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, and which was a real exciting event. And so they were all amazingly got through the whole day, which started at 5 and ended like about 8 o'clock. And they were obviously really happy about it, that they were being recognized. It was amazing. There were 81 this year. So overall in Syracuse over the last 3 or 4 years, a total of 240 or 250 vets got that trip. And it's a great honor for them at that time in their lives.
It's a nice way to say thank you.
It is. And they're all donations that are done to get the plane and everything else, and also volunteers. One volunteer goes with each one of them, and then they have others that kind of coordinate everything. And the sad part is they've done all of that. They still got a 200-person backlog, and they're World War II vets are not getting any younger, mm-hmm. and we're losing some every day. So hopefully that group will continue the wonderful work and get as many veterans who want to go to Washington.
Yeah, and in the budget, you were able to provide some funding for veterans. One thing would be for PTSD.
Correct, and there was items in there for veterans coming back out of the service and needing some help to fund one of the programs in Syracuse is Clear Path, which is an amazing program. So. Whereas after Vietnam, if you don't remember probably, but after Vietnam, it was like they were not heroes. They were not people serving the country. They were the enemy because all the protest movements and everything, like they had a choice where they were going to go and what they were going to do. And it was sad after Vietnam. There was just no recognition. In fact, they were embarrassed that they were soldiers. Now, in the last 5 to 10 years, it's turned around completely, which is a wonderful thing, being a veteran myself.
Mm-hmm. They need our support, and they deserve our support.
They certainly do.
Yeah. So, Baldwinsville, you honored some community service people.
We did. Every year, the Baldwinsville Volunteer Center recognizes a man of the year and a woman of the year. And I go as much as I can. I went the last few years, and the thing that's amazing is this has been going on since 1961. Now, how many continuous events honoring people along the same lines that they do in Baldwinsville? Secondly, the thing I mentioned, the two honorees, these were truly qualified, dedicated people. Sometimes you get an organization that's scratching to find out who to honor that next year. Mm-hmm. But Ed McManus was the one who was the most instrumental in getting a new library in Baldwinsville. And what's amazing about it, after the library went in, that whole stretch of land got renovated or new buildings put up, and it's really changed the face of part of Baldwinsville. And so it's really something else. The woman nominee was the individual who actually was involved in her church, involved in the volunteer center, involved in anything you can possibly imagine in that community, Teresa Gross. And she was the church, both of the honorees were from the same church, St. Mary's in Baldwinsville. And the priest, who's the pastor there, used to be my pastor at Our Lady of Pompeii. So when she got up, I said, you know, this you see all the good things she does? What a wonderful woman, what a good woman. I said, you don't know how good she is. In fact, she's so good that she hears Father Scardella's confession. rather than the other way around. And they got a kick out of that. And she's just a wonderful, wonderful lady. One of the nominees was back. She won it sometime in the 60s. She's 99 years old. And she's, from the podium, I said to her, what's the secret? What's the secret? Do you take a little shot of liquor every morning or something? She says, no, I don't drink. She says, but I volunteer. Now, that's pretty quick for a 99-year-old. She stood up and was as proud as can be. So it's a wonderful community, Baldwinsville, and they recognize they're great people.
Yeah. So congratulations to Teresa Gross and Edward McManus.
Right, and that event took place immediately before the veterans event at the honor flight event at the airport. So I was, I may have gone a little bit higher than the speed limit on the thruway, but I got there.
So now let's talk about some legislative issues that weren't in the budget and you're going to get to with the remainder of the session, starting with property taxes and rent control.
Correct. We have the 2% tax cap, but it's going to expire. And this probably is the most important tax relief, at least since I've been in the legislature, that we've ever put forward. And to make it expire would be horrible. So what we're trying to do, the Senate called for, try to get it in the budget, namely a permanent tax cap. Now, I know everybody, including myself, would like a pure legislature, that everything is determined based on its own merits. But when you see these bills like the 2% tax cap, when it has a sunset, in other words, it expires at a certain period of time, there's a reason for that. Because sometimes one legislative body isn't getting exactly what they want, but they know a key issue is going to come up 2 years. So they know they got a little more bargaining power. So you either do it for 2 years or it doesn't happen. And what I think the strategy was on this one, the downstate legislators in New York City that have rent control, that I don't particularly think makes any sense whatsoever. The market should drive whatever the rents are. But they have it, and that's no question what they're going to demand in return for the tax cap. So that's going to be something to watch for sure. There's another issue downstate clearly wants. When Bloomberg was mayor, he sought mayoral control of the schools. In other words, the mayor, the city who's providing much of the money along with the state to run the schools, rather than school board members and many school board members throughout the city and so many districts, that he requested and we provide him the mayoral control over the schools, and de Blasio wants the same thing. Quite frankly, Bloomberg was, a New York City resident, a lot more conservative than de Blasio is. And so I'm, it's a little different vote for me. However, that's going to be up for discussion as well.
What about the education tax credit?
Well, there you go again. This is something on the Republican side. We think that with the rising costs of education, you can only provide so much. If people want to donate, they should get a tax credit for donating to the schools. The argument against it, well, these are private schools, these are Catholic schools, these are Jewish schools, or whatever, Hebrew schools. It may be, that they're getting public money to those schools. And many people don't like that, especially the teachers' unions, and for obvious reasons. And the fact of the matter is, those schools save the New York State so much money, it's incredible, because those same people who are paying money to the private schools are also paying the same school taxes. So we should give them the choice. That's my opinion. But to make it more palatable, the tax credit bill would apply to both public and private schools. So public schools could benefit from it as well. So that's going to be, and on the other side of the ledger, the downstate crowd wants the DREAM Act, which would provide college tuition assistance for illegal immigrants, which they more politically call undocumented aliens. Same thing, they're not citizens of the United States. So that's going to come up again. And I personally don't think we should be providing non-citizens with education benefits for college when we can't provide enough for our citizens who end up going in deep in debt to get their college education. But it's a different thinking down in the city, and there's a ton of senators, especially assembly people down in the city.
Another measure, it was apparent in the budget hearings that raise the age of criminal responsibility. That's like one of the most memorable moments, really, I feel, from all of those hearings because of the questions that you asked and your colleagues asked because you weren't really getting answers to that. And that was something that they wanted to put in the budget.
That's the understatement of the year. In fact, the acting commissioner of the appropriate department hasn't been sent up for confirmation yet. And after the performance during the budget hearings, I doubt that we'll see him again because he had no answers whatsoever. So the concept was to make sure the mechanics of how it works. There's a lot of people that believe criminal responsibility shouldn't start until you're 18. For some offenses would still remain adult offenses even under this raise the age law. But the mechanics, what court do you go to first? Do you go to family court? Do you go to criminal court? Who transfers what? How does it work? Where are you going to put these kids that are now juveniles, offenders, rather than in prison? Where are you going to put them? Is there enough facilities to do that? And so forth. So none of those questions could be answered at the time, and that's what we're trying to get a hold of now, and that'll definitely be discussion before the end of June.
But I did notice in the budget there was money allocated for it. Why was that?
Well, I think the concept is that you probably have a majority of legislators in each house, clearly a majority, that would agree with that philosophy about when you treat juvenile offenders one way and another way. If it's a murder case, it's still adult, whether this law changes or not. It'd still be going to prison, but if convicted. So I think that was just a showing of good faith that if we can get all our stuff together and get all our answers answered, then there'll be the money already allocated. So I think that's a pretty clear indication that once these mechanical things are resolved, we're probably going to pass it this year.
So a little less than 2 months left in the legislative calendar. Do you expect it to go smoothly?
No, because these are all hot button issues. There's no question about it, and a lot of people feel strongly about many of these issues. But there's one difference between the end of the budget process, April 1, and the end of session. April 1, you don't have a budget. Government stops, and you don't pay people. And it happened in Washington once, and it was a disaster, and we don't want it to happen here. So the difference with end of session, there's none of these bills that either house is required to pass. Mm-hmm. So there'll be knockdown, drag-out battles about each side of the issue. But realistically, the pressure that's there to get it done is not nearly as high as the budget process.
And we have some great ceremonies coming up, the Veterans Hall of Fame and the Women of Distinction.
Yes.
Talk about them in future programs.
Yes, those are great because, you know, my feeling is that you look at the media, TV, internet, newspapers, magazines, everything seems to dwell on the bad person and the bad things that happen, the sensational things where people are acting crazy or not acting in the proper way. I think it's all the more important for us to recognize people who are doing the right thing, helping people, and that's what the Senate has traditionally done.
Yeah. So we will talk about Women of Distinction next week.
Sounds good.
All right. Thank you, Senator.
You're welcome.
And thank you for watching Your Voice with Senator John DeFrancisco. For additional information on what we discussed, defrancisco.misenate.gov.